In the melting pot of America's big city neighborhoods, specialty food shops have always identified the ethnic mix of people as surely as the sounds of a foreign tongue. One mark of an immigrant Jewish neighborhood, along with the kosher butcher, the bakery, and the deli, was the appetizing store. Appetizings, as they were often called, were small shops redolent with the smells of the old country. Their spotless display cases were filled with lox, herring, and smoked fish. You could find pickles by the barrel as well as dried fruits and nuts. Nowadays, smoked salmon, not lox, and whitefish come shrink-wrapped in America's mega supermarkets. But that special flavor and feeling of the appetizing store is being kept alive by a few stalwart families. Whenever I am in New York, I love to stop at Russ and Daughters on Houston Street or Barney Greengrass on the Upper West Side.
We've been in business since 1908. We first started up in Harlem. My grandfather was Barney Greengrass. Now I'm in business with my father, Mo, and I'm third generation. We started up in Harlem on 113th and St. Nicholas Avenue. And then in those good years, the Depression times of 1929, my grandfather moved the store down here. And we've been in the present location ever since. The decor, if you look around, it's a white porcelain enamel, which is, you have here, you have it on the showcase over there.
Oh, those wonderful ice boxes.
Right. It's actually, my father still calls it an ice box. You would be able to put the cakes of ice behind the mirror. You'd be able to put cakes of ice in and keep it cold. Now it's obviously motorized with refrigeration.
Right.
But it's that old deli, old appetizing store look, and we've tried to keep it. We really haven't changed it ever since.
So this still is an appetizing store. What is an appetizing store?
Appetizing is sort of, it specializes in smoked fish or pickled fishes, and that's what our mainstay is. We, you know, some people consider us a deli, but we're unique in the sense that if you look at our menu, we're 95% smoked fish items. Nova Scotia salmon, sturgeon, whitefish, kippered salmon, sable. Whereas if you go to a traditional deli, it's a corned beef, pastrami, things like that. We certainly carry those items in the, and the top of the line there as well, but that's not our strong point. Our focus is smoked fish.
I see. And why was in the early days, and outside it says, Barney Greengrass, the Sturgeon King?
Why not?
My grandfather, who was the Eastern European immigrant, came over around the turn of the century. He started with a horse and wagon, moved up to a push cart, and ultimately graduated to his own store. That was originally on Orchard Street for a few years. He then moved it to this location. It was half the size. And someplace along the line, he had no sons. He brought in his young teenage daughters, who were very pretty and very personable, and were able to do things and deal with the public, and that's what started to make the business. They then met their husbands through the store.
Right. Uh-huh.
And then we get down to the third generation, which is me.
And so how did you get into this?
Well, I'm here since I'm in utero, yes, literally. But the generation before me, my parents and aunts and uncles, certainly didn't have in mind me, my sisters, my cousins coming into the business.
Right.
They were working so hard, and this is hard work, so that we became professional, whatever. In fact, I became a lawyer, practiced law for 10 years. My father got sick, and the issue is my father was talking about selling Russell Hills.
Right.
I had to make a decision at that point to continue practicing law uptown with a fancy firm or take over Russ and Daughters.
Right.
I thought I could do both, but this is 20 years ago. The first day I came in here was the last day I practiced law, because in this family, this business is a lot more overwhelming than it appears. The product demands constant attention, buying early in the morning and going to smokehouses and picking out fish. It's a bit overwhelming. So there's no concept of doing anything other than being obsessed with this business.
We specialize in all types of smoked fish. Nova Scotia now is the most popular item. The Atlantic salmon, the eastern Nova Scotia that we sell, is the most popular item. Then comes our sturgeon, smoked whitefish, sable, which is smoked codfish, a little touch of garlic and paprika, baked salmon, also known as kippered salmon. It's pink in color. Years ago, it used to be white in color. The way they came up with that is that they would have a white salmon. It didn't have the eye appeal. So if you put it into a can, or if you put it, you know, if you smoked it inside, it didn't have the eye appeal. Who wants to eat a white salmon?
Right.
So they came up with the process of cutting it up into chunks and hot smoking it. Mm-hmm. And it's out of this world, very tasty. Now, those white salmon, those pale salmon, are now in short supply. So now they're using more of the Norwegian salmon or an Atlantic salmon, which are more in abundance. But actually, I, as a maven, I happen to like these even more because they're fattier. And it's like saying, it's like a Jewish expression. It's like saying, you know, customer will come and say, gee, the fish is too fatty. It's like saying the kalitzi, Shane, the bride is too pretty, the fish is too good. So.
In the beginning, there was just lox, meaning salt-cured salmon. That was the taste, salt-cured preserved fish. It was a taste that was brought over from Eastern Europe. The word lox comes from the Germanic word lax, meaning salmon. So there's a generic term for all salmons, lox from lax. After some period of time, industrialization and refrigeration, you didn't need such a heavy salt. The public's taste got away from a lot of the salt taste. Smoked salmons came filtering through and became the dominant choice for the public. However, there is a large portion of the public, particularly that shops here, who still wants that traditional taste of lox.
Right.
The best being the cut that's along the belly part of it, called belly lox.
So do you have one of the traditional lox here, or is it the Nova?
Where in the beginning my grandfather sold only lox, salted salmon, I at any one time can have 10 different types of salmons. Some salmons are a little saltier, some less salty, some, this is generically true. It was strictly a matter of taste. And in fact, on a fish itself, it tastes differently depending upon where you are on the fish. The beginning of a fish will be leaner and a little saltier. And as you go up the fish gets wider and fatter and will have less of a taste of salt and more creamy, silky texture. Some people prefer it drier, some prefer it fatter.
And the belly is the fat.
The belly is the fattest portion. The original Jewish population, which my grandfather and going on through the generations, we traditionally served, were into fat fish, fatter, tasting better. And as it turns out now, fatter in terms of fish being healthier. Because of omega-3 fatty acids. The fat of the fish is better for you, it reduces your body's cholesterol. But that was the original taste.
Can I see the belly of a fish?
Absolutely.
Of a salmon?
Herman, you can hold one up. The belly,
yes, I'm just gonna...
right, the belly runs this half of the salmon. See, with the lines, these are actually fat lines, run down through the salmon.
Can you show me how you slice the salmon?
Herman, Herman's hands, we have Herman's hands insured by Lloyd's of London. There's this perception that the thinner, the better. I think the perception, since the product is somewhat pricey now, is the thinner will go farther. If you're going to put it on with cream cheese and you have this very thin slice, which we do all of the time, you're not going to taste the salmon. Yes? The older customer wants to cut a little thicker and they want to taste salmon, particularly if there's something with it like cream cheese or cream cheese and scallion. If, on the other hand, you're just going to put it on a piece of black bread, yes? Then you can have, and a very mild black, you can have thin slices of salmon laid on top of that. Let's take a walk down, and I'll show you about herrings. The mother of all herrings is the schmaltz herring. This is the herring my grandfather started with. This is the herring that was brought over, the taste of it, the concept, from Eastern Europe. The better herring, schmaltz means fat.
Right.
The better herrings are fat herrings. And the herrings were caught and thrown in barrels and salt cured, and they stayed there. And that's what a family ate on. A poor Jewish family.
During the week.
During the week would have a herring and some boiled potatoes and maybe a piece of bread.
Mark invited me into his Brooklyn kitchen for a modern version of a traditional recipe.
What we're going to do today is to do a twist on the standard Jewish herring meal from the Lower East Side.
Okay.
The Jews in the turn of the century would come to the pushcart vendors that sold the herrings like my grandfather.
Mm-hmm.
And they would get their herrings whole, and these were just pure salted herrings. They were preserved in barrels and salt. Mm-hmm. And have those herrings wrapped up in the daily newspaper, which at that point was the Fovitz, the Jewish Forward, or the Tag. And they'd take it home, and they throw some potatoes in the same wrapping, and maybe some onion, and if they felt a little flush, maybe they'd put a little butter in it, and throw this whole thing into their coal stove.
Mm-hmm.
Yes, and that was their
herring
not
meal.
Not cold stove, cold.
Cold, C-O-A-L, cold stove, yes. I guess often the coal stoves were also cold, but when they were hot, they would make this herring dish, yes? So we have a little twist on it now because it's not easy for everybody to get the Jewish Daily Forward, the Tag, whatever. We do it in parchment paper now, which is fairly easy to get.
You can get the Jewish Daily Forward in English, but you can get it in Yiddish, but not every day.
Right, and it doesn't work in English. I've tried it. It works only in Yiddish, the recipe.
I love that.
So we stick to parchment paper.
Okay.
And lest anybody be concerned, this is not the same kind of parchment that this Torah is written on. This is parchment for cooking.
Okay.
And what we're going to do is very simple, very basic, but the important thing here is that we're dealing with the right herring. Now, this becomes a little trickier because people around the country are basically buying herring in jars and it's been sauced, pickled, cream sauce, wine sauce. What we need for this recipe is a pure salted herring.
All right.
You can find that in some specialty shops like Russ and Daughters, but you need that for this recipe. It's pure, unadulterated.
And what kind of herring?
It's in the nature of a schmaltz herring, which means a fat herring.
Okay.
Now, what we need to do is take the whole herring and remove some of the salt.
Mm-hmm.
The salt, again, was the preservative. Now we're going to take some of the salt out,
okay.
Not all of it. So we soak it overnight in ice-cold water, and we mm-hmm. change the water once or twice. Once we've done that, you see, we're going to fillet the herring. Now, here's a herring.
Uh-huh.
In the olden days, what my kids call the olden days, they did this whole. The herring was whole, yes?
Mm-hmm.
But it's hard. That's a hard sell these days, a herring with skin and bone. So we can fillet the herring. It's really not very difficult. A little bit messy.
Mm-hmm.
You basically slit the belly of the herring. And if you're lucky, it's kind of like a surprise in a Cracker Jack box.
Oh, look
you
at
get
that.
This, which is called milts.
Mm-hmm.
The milts is the inside of the male herring. And my grandmother, and maybe yours, would have made the original cream sauce,
right.
A parva cream sauce, because they didn't use milk product,
yes.
Out of this.
Absolutely.
Yes? That doesn't happen anymore. And it's rare that you see this kind of thing also.
And this is like the guts of the herring?
Actually, it would be the equivalent of the sperm of the male herring. I mean, the female has the roe.
Right.
This would be the sperm.
Huh.
And
okay.
When they mate, you know, that's what happened. We don't want to get into the detail
All right.
about that.
Okay.
Right. This is a show
so
about
we know
food,
this is...
not sex. Let's stick to food now, and we're going to scrape the herring. We've opened it. We're going to scrape it. Yes, scrape out the insides.
Are you telling me you can do this in your sleep?
It's genetic with me. Now, what people call this process is filleting, but the Russ family, and I'm the third generation of the Russ family,
mm-hmm.
We don't use the word filleting. This is really a labor of love. Some people mm-hmm. go, oh, herring, ah, oh, I'm filleting. This is a labor of love. When we do this, yes,
yeah.
We slit the back like this, and then you peel the skin off kind of gently. We call this undressing the herring.
Oh, see, going back to sex, right?
Well, food okay. and sex, particularly Jewish food and Jewish sex, right?
You just peel it so easily.
Right. Well, you've soaked it out, and it softens it up,
uh-huh.
And we just peel it. And you can see on a nice herring, you see that nice shiny skin?
Oh, yeah.
Yes, that's a very nice texture. And then we separate, just with our hands, the backbone
uh-huh.
from the fillets, like this. Yes?
Mm-hmm.
There's one fillet. And here's two fillets.
Beautiful.
This is what we're going to work with. Now, there are little pin bones in here that should be taken out. We've done that already in the interest of time, so we have the same fillet here as here. We take our parchment paper.
Mm-hmm.
Now, this comes in square sheets, so... you figure out how to make a circle with the scissors.
Right.
And we lay that down. And the first thing we're going to put across this, since we made a little money, is some pats of butter. So we'll just put a couple of pats of butter just ahead of the diameter.
Now you use the parchment paper if you can't find the forward?
If you can find the forward in Yiddish, use that. If not, stick to the parchment
paper. It doesn't
work
in English?
In English, it's just something that loses something there.
Flavor.
There you go. Use that finger. I like that finger.
Okay.
That's perfect.
Good. All right.
Next thing we're going to do, and you're going to help since
okay.
we work together, we're like family here, right?
All right.
Is layer just a couple of slices of potato across the center.
And I noticed they're cooked, right?
We cook them sliced so that You don't break them up when you slice them. So we slice them first, cook them. We leave them with the skin on. I mean, any Jew worth his salt is going to have a potato with the skin on because allegedly all the vitamins are in there. That's it.
Okay.
You don't want to give that up except latkes. You can give it up for latkes.
Even then, health food stores or vegetarian cookbooks very often say don't peel the latkes.
All right. So we knew this a long time ago.
If you're lazy.
The next thing on our layering is onions, which we have sautéed.
Right.
Just in some vegetable oil. We also took 3 cloves of allspice. Mm-hmm. Allspice is a wonderful spice. And we, in this old-fashioned mortar and pestle, everything old-fashioned here, we break it up and that we just dump that into our sauteing onions.
Okay.
We're going to bring those onions over,
all
if
right.
you would. And here, well, let's do it with a fork maybe. It's easy so we have the right amount. I know you're an onion freak.
Yeah, I like onions.
Yeah, and we're going to put another layer of it on too, but we don't want to overwhelm all the taste. This is going to be the combination of the tastes and the textures, the herring and the potato kind of counterbalances the salt of the herring, and the onions kind of do something to that. Now, next thing we do is take our herring fillet, and we're going to slice it in advance. Yeah. All right, let's just slice it. Look at that. Isn't that pretty?
Mm-hmm.
That shines.
Beautiful.
Yes? That's a good-looking herring.
So how do you feel when you look at a herring? Do you go back to
the
roots?
I do. A herring to me is like genetic, you know? Mm-hmm. I have something herring blood in my blood. Or if they did a DNA test, they'd match me up with a herring.
And so you eat it too, you don't just sell it.
I love herring, yes. And the interesting thing is, since I see lots of different kinds of people in my business, I find more and more people getting back to herring. You know, herring got a bum rap in this country from the beginning. In Europe, herring is a prized food. Mm-hmm. They fought wars over herring. Acts of Parliament were passed to protect herring fisheries. Still in Holland, the first herrings goes to the queen. Mm-hmm. Somehow, when it got to this country, it was relegated to the basement, and it was kind of regarded as an old world poor food.
Right.
Nobody
everyday
wanted
food.
Anything to do with it other than the Jews who brought that taste with them. Yes, or the Eastern Europeans. But the next generations along rejected herring. Now, herring is this wonderful food that's very rich in vitamins. Mm-hmm. It has lots of its protein and calcium, omega-3 fatty acids, and lends itself to lots of different kinds of preparations, different kinds of sauces. There must be 10 different kinds of sauces for herrings. So I see people getting back into it now. But what we're dealing with right now is pure herring, and we're just kind of baking it with some very basic ingredients. So we're going to take this now. I'm reaching across, it's a little acrobatic feat, and we're going to lay that right across the top.
Skin side up.
We've removed the skin, but the top up, right?
Top up.
Top up. Look at that.
Looks beautiful.
Isn't it?
Smells.
Mm. Now you're going to, when this thing is cooked, you're going to faint from pleasure.
Right.
Now, we're going to do a little more potato.
Okay.
You want to do that? Just lay some potato on there. This is good. This is magnificent.
Looks yummy.
You're doing very well with this, by the way. You have some natural aptitude for playing with herring. and then we'll do some more onion, if you would. Yeah.
All right.
At this point, you can put as much as you want because, you know.
Yeah, I like the onion.
We're about ready for closure on this thing.
It smells so good. You know, this wasn't just peddlers in the Lower East Side that did this, but Jewish peddlers that went across the country, they would bring these salted herrings and they would put them on the open fireplace.
Uh-huh. Okay, now we'll just take another pat of butter for the top. There we go. One here and one there.
Now, this looks like a good-sized portion.
Isn't it?
You could use this for a gourmet dinner.
Right. I tell you, though, that you serve this. Well, we'll talk about it when it's cooked.
Okay.
Now, here's the tricky part. Yeah?
All right.
Tricky part is to get this folded over and crimp the edges so that we have a tight seal. The best one at crimping, I guess she's learned by crimping is my wife. She learned from crimping my style how to crimp. If we can get her in here,
okay.
She'll show us how to crimp this thing.
Hi, Maria.
Hi, John.
Hi, Maria. Do your thing here.
Okay.
She actually is the better cook.
You did a very good job here.
Did I?
Yeah.
You're just being kind today.
No,
Mm-hmm. Now, the important thing is the corners here. Really yeah. very tight. Double.
Put them over twice.
Yeah. And here the same.
So this is sort of a nouvelle, old-fashioned recipe.
Yeah, sort of. So now you start folding it like this. Very tight, so the when you start cooking, the steam doesn't escape.
Now, there is this inherent desire while you're doing this to want to staple it. But you don't do that, right? Mm-hmm. Number one, it wouldn't taste particularly good with staples in it. And number two, it wouldn't be historically accurate to have staples. So you got to go through this process of crimping the thing. A sewing machine might be interesting also.
Also, it's very important that it has enough room. Mm-hmm. Not to.
I see. So that.
The
this could be served at the most elegant dinner party by doing mm-hmm. this.
And the way it tastes, it's no longer identifiable as an old world herring. Salty herring. It's magnificent.
You couldn't use tin foil for this, or could you?
Yeah, you could.
But it's not the same mm-hmm. yeah. presence.
Okay. Yeah.
Now we're going to just, Marie, you want to get that pan? Mm-hmm. We've preheated the oven to 400 degrees. Mm-hmm. We're just going to put it on here. I guess you can make about four of them if you laid them this way at a time.
Right. Yeah, like that.
Mm-hmm. Is that what you do?
Yeah, usually you put it like that. It goes four at a time.
Right. And then it's at 400 degrees. We're going to cook it for 12 minutes. Set our timer. And it'll be wild when we open this thing.
Check it at 10. Can't wait to eat it.
Okay. I think I heard the bell go off, and Maria's taking mm-hmm. this out of the oven.
Well, I can smell the aroma.
Yeah,
it just smells
wild.
Oh,
look at
wow.
that.
Look at this.
We're going to pop it right on here.
Be careful. It's hot.
It's hot.
Beautiful.
Look, see
Believe
this?
Me, they never had something as beautiful on the Lower East Side.
Well, maybe it looked even prettier with the newspaper, the tog, or the fold. But look, you can smell that as it's coming out.
Uh-huh.
You can put this in the fanciest dinner party, one of these, and let people just open it.
I'm going to do it at my house.
And the trick is to just put your nose in there, and that's the smell that will take you back to the shtetl.
Looks just fabulous.
Okay, let's get in
here. Lower East Side. I think my grandfather had it when he lived in the Lower East Side.
I bet he did. I bet he lived on this. Go ahead. Jump in there. Make sure you get a piece of everything.
A
little herring. And it's going to be hot now. Be careful. You got yours?
Mmm. Hot.
Mmm.
Delicious.
The taste of your roots.
The taste of my roots and yours.
Yes, for sure.
My grandfather is watching.
Uh-huh, and he's smiling.
To learn more about Jewish cooking in America with Joan Nathan, visit us online at www.pbs.org. Companion products for Jewish cooking in America, including Joan Nathan's updated cookbook, a CD of the music score, and a two-hour video of series highlights and recipes, are available by calling 1-800-235-3000. Credit cards are accepted. Jewish Cooking in America with Joan Nathan is made possible by the Joseph S. and Diane H. Steinberg Charitable Trust, proud supporters of the arts, children's causes, and the preservation of Jewish heritage. And by Hebrew National, proud sponsors of Jewish Cooking in America, serving you and your family traditional kosher franks and delicatessen products since 1905. Hebrew National, we answer to a higher authority.
And by Lender's Bagels, our idea of a perfect day is warm and comforting and satisfying all around. Lender's Bagels. The perfect circle.
And by the following private individuals and family foundations.
Thank you.
This has been a co-production of Joan Nathan, Frappe Productions, and Maryland Public Television.
This is PBS.